Brothers and sisters, that's my third video. I wanted to do some preaching, which I already did, but a little bit tired out. Been busy, it's so hot here. But anyway, I want to talk about, I've got pages of notes, brothers and sisters. What the Lord had revisited me back to the stuff I was studying when I was preparing to write the book. And I've made videos. If you've been watching my videos way back, you can go back and watch my old videos. When I first started, the first year, until I started Joshua's ministry, about all the stuff I was talking about was things the Lord was showing me. But the Lord has given me much more detail now. I want to talk about some things. There's all the roads of the enemy lead to the Antichrist. We know that. They have different things that they're trying to do. I mean, the devil tries to steal people away from the Lord. As Jesus said, the devil comes not but to kill, steal, and destroy the enemy. John chapter 10, verse 9. But I have come that you might have life and life to the fullest. So the enemy comes to kill, steal, and destroy. So he uses all means necessary, whether it be to get you to be a sodomite, to get you to be a drunk, to get you to be on drugs, to get you to be a Buddhist, a Hindu, a Muslim. It doesn't matter which, you know, choose your poison. The devil's got lots of poison for you, and he's got it wrapped up and packaged up to sound good. Now, the Islam one, I can't figure out how anybody would go for a religion that says God wants you to die for him, when in Christianity, God died for us. But a religion that wants you to wear black, you know, it's a death cult, and go out and be a suicide bomber and blow people up, and then you're going to get, you know, you're not supposed to be doing all this stuff on earth, but when you go to heaven, you're having a big orgy. But somehow on earth, it's bad, but in heaven, it's good to have an orgy. Somehow, wacky contradiction, you know, blow yourself up and you can have an orgy in heaven for eternity. Really weird. You know, here's a clue. Any religion that wears black, dressed up like a witch in a burqa and all that, I give you a clue. It sounds like prison. Not something good, but sounds like something bad. When Allah wants you to die for him instead of Jesus died for us. God died for us. Anyway, brothers and sisters, all of these different groups, they have their own plan to rule the world. But ultimately, they're all controlled by Satan. And they're ultimately living all to the same place. They're all leading to the pit of hell. Ultimately, the Lord will have the victory. Okay, but in the meantime, let's look at some of the things they're trying to do, because they're trying to figure out. I just want to start reading some facts. I need to get organized. I mean, I could make 100 videos, but let me just get started here. Okay, another name for the Illuminati, or the original name for the Illuminati, is Perfectibilist. Perfectibilist. Perfect, I-B-I-L-I-S-T. And someone that is a perfectibilist, like a preacher of perfectibilist, is a parfait. Parfait. Like, you know, I guess you go, you know, like you eat some parfait. So, the Qatars, which is one of the things the Lord gave me before. The Lord's been showing me that fleur-de-lis and all that. And all about France. There's two different paths about that. You know, now when I was writing the book and Rosemary Kelly was helping me edit it, I was talking to her, and I can't remember how much I publicly made videos about and how much stuff I just discussed with her through messaging as we were writing the book. The Lord had really showed me about the Basque region, which is on the border of France and Spain. They want to have an independent nation, and the Lord had showed me about this, and I'd seen that, like, in New Orleans, there's Loyola University or wherever it is, or St. Louis or whatever, and they got a fleur-de-lis. Okay, even though the fleur-de-lis was not the symbol of the Jesuits, this was long before the Pope, the new Pope, who is a Jesuit. And so I was looking at, you know, the Jesuits, and I looked at all about Loyola. Now, this Loyola guy, which is a whole other topic, this guy was a New Age. You know, he had these spiritual exercises. He, you know, he had all this wacky. So there's two wacky nuts that are both in that area. There's Clairvaux. This guy's last name is Clairvaux. You heard of clairvoyant. There's Clairvaux, who says that that milk squirted out of the breast of a Mama Mary statue squirted him in the mouth, and he had a revelation, you know, that to worship Mary. Sounds like it's not from God. Not as bad as a jihad, but definitely maybe not on the right team. Maybe not on the white chest team, maybe on the black chest team. But anyway, brothers and sisters, that's Clairvaux, who's another guy. Look, it's also French. This Clairvaux, now see, I'm just trying to flow as the Lord is leading me, and I got all these notes. So let me just flow with that Clairvaux as I switched up. Because Loyola, who Ignatius Loyola, who started the Jesuits, which the Pope is a Jesuit, that's kind of the train that you're following for the anti or the false prophet. That's the devil's black train, that long black train, like the song, a long black train that's for false prophet. Now the Antichrist train, let's go with Clairvaux here. Now Clairvaux, like I said, clairvoyant, he has this milk squirting out of the breast of a Madonna statue. Squirting him in the mouth. He had some revelation from that. Now this same mystic devil worshiper, both of them are devil worshipers, and the Jesuits is a whole nother story. Go watch, there's a documentary called Terrors Among Wheat. Go watch that, and there's a follow-up to that too, a second part. You can learn all about the Jesuits, who are really wicked, wicked people. Wicked. And I made videos about that before the Pope and talked about it. Of course, it's really wicked. Nothing to do with the fact that this Pope is a Jesuit, which is evil. But anyway, and this Clairvaux guy, he is the one who convinced the Pope at the time to endorse the Knights Templar, because they had started this Knights Templar group and they called themselves something else before, but they became the Poor Knights of Jesus and all this. But they went to Jerusalem first. I'm not going to do a video on the history of the Knights Templar. You can go look it up yourself. But the point is this Clairvaux dude, who was a big-time mystic and a Mary worshiper, he endorsed the Knights Templar and convinced the Pope to make them, you know, accountable only to him. Now, the Knights Templar did lots of things. They made the first banking system, modern banking system and all this, because people would deposit their gold with the Knights Templar in France. They would go to the Holy Land, and then they would draw out their money from the Knights Templar there, so they wouldn't carry their gold along the route and be robbed. So the whole thing of checks came out, and the whole idea, that's why checks is originally spelled, you know, Q-U-E, it's French, you know, from the Knights Templar and all that. So they did lots of things, and you know, that I could get into. But the link back to Nimrod is really, Nimrod is our first type of the Antichrist. Okay, and Nimrod back there at the Tower of Babel. And the same lies of Tammuz, you know, and her child. Tammuz was supposed to be the wife there of Nimrod, she had an immaculate conception and all this. It goes to Egyptians with Isis. And Isis, her husband was Horus, and he was chopped up. And I mentioned this before. This is just so, I'm going to just run through it, okay? Just follow me. And I've made videos about this. It's the same principality. It's the same, you know, worshiping the goddess worship, which is try to insult God. God is masculine. This goddess worship. Okay, it goes back from Tammuz, really, there in Babylon, because the devil knew that the seed of the woman was coming. Revelation 3:15, God prophesied in front of the serpent to Eve, you know, that the seed of the woman would crush the head of the seed of the serpent. So Satan heard it, Eve heard it, Adam heard it. Okay, it's written in the Bible. There was the seed of the woman coming. All humans born are seed of a man. A man has the seed. The woman carries the seed and delivers a baby. But Jesus had no earthly father, so he's the only person born who was the seed of a woman, because it was her DNA. You know, and then God made Jesus, so he's unique. He is the only one that's the seed of a woman. So that's the Messiah. So you got Nimrod's wife, this Tammuz. She had this, you know, after her husband died and all this, then she got pregnant, you know, and then came up with this idea of it was some kind of a virgin birth and all this. So when the devil's people, when you listen to what atheists say and stuff, they'll say, well, you know, Christianity's just copying this ancient stuff. Well, the answer is that the devil knew about it, and the devil is trying to sabotage the gospel and sabotage the real virgin birth and the real Virgin Mary and the real Messiah with some old junk along the way. So first you see Tammuz and her kid, and then there's more. There's many more, but let's just skip on to... You see there in Egypt, you have Isis. You know, and it's kind of a coincidence or weird or something's going on there with this, you know, with this terrorist group, army, Isis, uses that same name. But the goddess Isis, represented by the star Sirius, Isis, her husband Horus, was chopped up by his brother in 13 pieces. Now, you know, that's this is deep, man. You know, we have the 13 colonies. That's a whole other thing. It's true, though. Jesus and his 12 disciples, there's 13. So everything the devil does is, and let me just touch on these points as they come into my head. How about that? Try to follow a sequence here. Devil does everything to copy Jesus. We have 13 colonies. None of this is by mistake. And the District of Columbia, you know, it's right there in the middle. You know, so it's like Jesus and the 12 disciples. But this is the devil's, you know, mocking that, copying that for the Antichrist. So Horus's body was chopped up into 13 pieces. And his brother Set did that to him and threw his body, but his phallus was eaten by a fish. So that's why she made a golden phallus, and then she was able to supernaturally become pregnant. She put his body back together with a golden phallus, and then she had a child. Let's see, Horus, what is his name? Osiris is his son. See, or Horus is the son and Osiris is the dad. I get them backwards. Anyway, go look it up. It doesn't matter. Moot point, Osiris and Horus. And so maybe it's Osiris is the dad and Horus is the son, vice versa, whatever. So anyway, when you know, this is the type, really, where you got your Nephilim, okay? This is Nephilim, the Antichrist. You know, it's a Nephilim. It's as above, so below. It's the fallen angels mating with women, as we see in Genesis chapter 6. That's what this is all going to, okay? That's what it's all about. The square and compass, as above, so below. It's the male and the female. All of the things they do is going to that same thing. So when you see the Washington Monument, the obelisk in Vatican Square, all those obelisks, they are all phallic symbols. I mean, this is just so goofy, and something that something like Howard Stern would come up with. This is like seventh grade potty humor of teenage boys. That you would think they would come up with this religious ideas. You know, this is what these people believe. That's what's so wacky. The elite of this world believe this stuff. They really believe it. There's power and magic in this stuff. They really believe it. That's what's so crazy about it. Like Bohemian Grove. Go look up Bohemian Grove. It's a real place. And the people really worship the god Moloch there and offer a sacrifice. But it's an effigy. They offer a child sacrifice to the god. It's called the cremation of care. You can go look that up. To prove that it's real, if you've never seen me talk about it, go watch David Gergen, who is an advisor to two or three different presidents, denying Bohemian Grove and cremation of care with Alex Jones. Go look at that video, and you will see that it is real, and these people take it serious, and they're willing to kill for it. To keep their little goofy, adolescent potty humor as a religion a secret. So, it's the sacred feminine. That's what they're worshiping. That's why that's so dangerous with Catholicism, with this elevation of Mary as co-redeemer and all this stuff. It's going right to the worship of Mother Earth, of Gaia and all that. Anything to blaspheme God. Bringing in a woman goddess. Like even supposed to be, Adam had a first wife, and then she wouldn't obey Lilith. You've heard of the Lilith thing. This is a big lesbian fest, music fest of promoting lesbianism, and the Lilith fair, a Lilith fest of rock music, of women musicians. You know, these lesbian women musicians promoting that because Lilith rebelled against Adam and refused to let him be, you know, the boss over her, so she went and did her own thing. That's why God sent down Eve. So Lilith is women's liberation that we have today, which, you know, I've talked about in detail in the book. Of course, women's liberation was actually backed by the CIA. Now, the CIA backed it for one reason that they state was to have more taxpayers, let women work so we have more tax base. But in reality, Satan's plan was to destroy the family, take women out of the house, destroy the family structure. Look what we have today. Look what's going on today in the United States and around the world. Families being destroyed. The way God made the pattern with Adam and Eve and Seth and on down, that pattern that God established is being destroyed. It's part of the end times, brothers and sisters. But back to the Antichrist. Now, so as I mentioned, this wild facts that that the Lord had shown me, but I didn't really think about it. This Osiris, or Horus, one or the other, the dad, his body was cut into 13 body parts, as I mentioned. The phallus being one of them, the phallus was lost. Then we see 13 colonies in the U.S. We see Jesus plus his 12 disciples is 13. See, this is what they're doing. They're trying to pattern all these things, brothers and sisters, after, you know, what God's doing and what, you know, something good, they try to do something bad with it. So let me see. So, now this Loyola, who founded the Jesuits, and the new Pope that we have now, is a Jesuit. A forerunner to the false prophet, or will hand the keys of Catholicism over to the false prophet and or the Antichrist. And I made a video of a dream I had about him reading out of this black magic book, and it was, you know, it was wicked stuff. What you can see now, since he's been the Pope, he's really going, you know, even though Catholicism to me is, you know, it's not really Christianity, okay, but I'm talking about now they're going off into wickedness. I mean, real evil, not just lukewarm, watered down, not really Christianity, going into satanic stuff. It's a totally different level. Okay, what's going now? So this Loyola, which I need to research further, Loyola, who founded the Jesuits, he had got a revelation from God. He had these spiritual exercises, all this New Age stuff, projection and visualization and all this demonic stuff he was doing, and all about Mama Mary and all that, and killing anybody that didn't bow to the Pope. Loyola got a revelation from God about who the Holy Spirit is. And the Holy Spirit is really a person, a specific person. And I got to do more research on it, but it's totally wacky stuff. And I think that's going to lead more to the false prophet and what, you know, where the Pope will go. And I've got to research that. So I'll just put that out there. Haven't had a chance to follow up on that. Now, the Lord has shown me tons of stuff. As you guys know, the number one thing the Lord has shown me is this Florida Lee 1,000 times. And then when I woke up the other morning, the Lord spoke to me, Lorraine. Lorraine, the city in France, Lorraine. Now, Lorraine is where Joan of Arc was from. And I haven't got to research all about it. You know, I've been there. I didn't realize it till after I was looking at this stuff. I went to the 50th anniversary of the D-Day invasion there. When I was in the Army, I was in Germany. And I went to the 50th anniversary of the D-Day invasion in Normandy. And I took this tour. It was like a 4-day tour. And part of that trip, we stopped like a half a day in Lorraine. And we ate dinner there. And we went to the place where Joan of Arc was burned at the stake. Now, so, you know, it's weird that, you know, I've been there and didn't even know at the time that it would be somehow connected to this today. Isn't that amazing how God operates? I was a backslider at the time. So when was that? 1994, 95, whatever it was, 94. So anyway, brothers and sisters, the thing about Lorraine, one thing, Joan of Arc was burned at stake there. The stuff that Joan of Arc saw, I didn't even watch the movie. I haven't seen the movies about Joan of Arc. I don't even know that much about her. And I got to research it. Maybe some of you guys know a lot about it, but there's something to do with her visions and what she did and all that that's related to the kingdom of Antichrist. And I don't know what yet. I have no idea. I got to look at it. There's a lot there. So that's, I'm just throwing out there just for the sake of time, the things that the Lord has told me, and it leads somewhere. Okay, so I'll give it out there, and I know there's some of you guys who know all about it. Now, another thing about Lorraine is this double cross is there. It's a long, regular cross with a smaller one at the top. And then the thing that the Lord was telling me is, not only does that, you know, the Knights Templar had used this some too, but it's a double cross. In English, it's a play on words. To double cross someone is to be a traitor. So all of you guys who might be watching me who are Catholics, I believe that's what the Lord has shown me about that. Not only about the Knights Templar, but the double crossing. As I said, I don't consider Catholicism as part of biblical Christianity. But I don't consider it as Satanism either. But that's where it's going. There's a double cross coming. And then maybe the Pope is going to hand the keys to the false prophet, the Antichrist, or endorse the Antichrist, whatever he's going to do. And millions of Catholics who believe that the Pope is infallible, and they're going to do whatever he says. Instead of using their own brain that God gave them and the Word of God that God gave us, which we all can go buy a Bible. It's available basically everywhere in the world. I don't know about China or whatever, but the Bible's available everywhere, basically. And you can go look it up yourself. I don't need any man to be a mediator for you. The Bible says there's one mediator between God and man, the man Jesus Christ. A double cross is coming. I've made videos about this before. And I've said this before. I urge all Catholics to leave, you know, come out from under this Pope. I urge all Catholics to do that and come to biblical Christianity. I'm not sponsoring or promoting any denomination. I don't have anything to sell of denominations or anything to anybody. But come out from that, because they're going off the cliff into darkness, total darkness, 100%. Not where they are now, 90%, but 100%. It's going to be no gospel involved anymore, no Jesus part of it. I'm telling you that it's coming, a double cross. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so let's see. Let me just follow that line of that thing before. I might not even be able to get. I have only looked at three or four things I wrote down, brothers and sisters. I got about 8 or 10 pages full of notes. I'm still on page one. As I said before, okay, it goes from this lies and this mystery religions goes from Babylon, Sumeria, the Sumerian tablets, Zechariah Sitchin. If you can look him up. His translations are wrong. He just arbitrarily made up his own translations. Other scholars who have looked at it, this guy's just adding on and making up and using his imagination in those translations of the Sumerian tablets. You know, he's the only one that did that. Nobody else was checking his work. And I'm telling you, most of the stuff in there is fabrications and exaggerations. So if you look at anything that Zechariah Sitchin says, make sure you find some other credible historical experts, not some clowns on YouTube who are not professionals, who can look at those Sumerian tablets and tell you what it really says. Because Zechariah Sitchin exaggerated what's in there or changed it. This is his own imagination. It's not translated properly. Sumerian tablets. Okay. Anyway, you go from Samaria, Babylon, you go to Egypt. As I stopped, and I was talking about Egypt and Isis and all that. Then you go to Greece, all those other ones. You got the Greek mythology. Then you got the Roman stuff. Okay, and then you get into Islam, and then the Knights Templar, they got all this ancient mystery religion. Some of it came from the Middle East, from the Muslims. Some came from the Far East. All of that, they kind of brought, you know, it's in the center. The Middle East is in the middle of everything there. They brought all this different mystical, ancient, Gnostic wisdom together. And then it came forward to the Rosicrucians and what is the modern-day Freemasons. They all have bits and pieces of that, of this ancient Gnostic, satanic wisdom from the knowledge of good and evil all the way back. It's the same old crap, and I use the word crap after Dr. Crapper, who invented the flushable toilet. It's the same old junk repackaged. And that's why they call it New Age when really it's the Old Age. It's the same old lies repackaged with different names. So if you start looking at any of these different belief systems, you will see that they all funnel back to one source, ultimately back to Satan. Even the Illuminati, of course, the Illuminated One, the Light Bearer, Lucifer himself, same old lies, brothers and sisters. And the world leaders that we have today, the elite of this world, the richest people in the world, they all truly believe this stuff. They are all truly faithful to their different beliefs that lead to Lucifer, to hell, to death and destruction. They follow it, brothers and sisters. So let me see. I don't know if I want to get into all this stuff. Let's see. I'm already at 23 minutes. The Kabbalah people, the Kabbalists, that's a whole other video. I could do a video on the Kabbalists. Who they think the Christ is going to be is the son of Joseph. That's why the Holy Grail, which is connected to the Knights Templar, the Holy Grail really comes from that word Rachel. Rachel, Grail, and it comes from the root word of really Rachel. And they believe that Joseph will be the father of the Messiah instead of Judah. So this one possibility or part of the bloodline of the Antichrist will be partly from the seed of Joseph. I believe he'll also be partly Gentile and from the, you know, descendant of the Roman Empire leaders, you know, as Vespasian or General Titus, his son, be a there'll be partial blood, Roman blood too. But I believe he will be partially from Israeli blood, specifically, people say Jews. Well, a Jew is from the tribe of Judah. But this is the tribe of Joseph. And the son of Rachel. So they use the text from the end of Genesis when Jacob spoke a blessing on all of his children. And he said that, you know, that Joseph is a fruitful bow, a bow, whatever you call it, like a cornucopia looking thing or whatever. So they're trying to say that, matter of fact, this notebook that I bought that was for a dollar in the States about 10 years ago. Yeah, 10 years ago I bought this for a dollar because it was on clearance because it's so ugly. It's my second prayer journal. Look at that. There's a fruitful bow, or whatever you want to call it, right there on the top of each page. I guess this book is kind of like for girls, not for boys, but I bought it for a dollar. Hey, it's a hardback paper notebook, but it's coming apart because I've had it so many years and carried it around the world. But anyway, so that's where they get that, one of the prophecies, you know, that it would be a descendant of Joseph, whereas we know the Messiah descended from Judah, not Joseph. So they're looking for somebody from that bloodline. So that's a good possibility that Israel will accept this guy as a Messiah because he's got that bloodline from Joseph through Rachel, the wife, the second wife of Jacob, the younger sister of Leah. Judah came from Leah, the first wife of Jacob. So, and also the root word for grail and Rachel and all is also the cup. Remember, Joseph gave a prophecy to the cup bearer, and the cup bearer was restored to the right hand of Pharaoh. Then he told the Pharaoh later on, oh yeah, there's a, you know, I met this Hebrew who can translate dreams. The cup bearer, the cup of Pharaoh. And then you see, again, Joseph is related to the cup of his cup that he hid in the sack of Benjamin, the other son of Rachel. He hid the cup, his chalice in there, and then he made them come back and accuse him of thievery, you know, when he was revealing that he was their brother. If you have read your Bible in Genesis, we see the story. So here we see Joseph related to a grail, Rachel, which is the root word for grail too, also from the same root word. And then we see the cupbearer of Pharaoh and the cup that was hidden in Benjamin's sack, all related. So that's where they get this, the Kabbalists get this idea from, that it's saying that, and Joseph is a fruitful bow, and you read that prophecy from his father on his deathbed about Joseph. That's where they get this idea from, that the Messiah would come from Joseph. Now there's, and also the problem with Rachel, brothers and sisters, the real thing about Rachel, which I'm going to get into later, is the comforter. Now see, well see, now the Lord is connecting it for me. I my notes were so scattered. Loyola, the Jesuit, original, the founder of the Jesuits there in Basque, he said that God had revealed to him about the real Holy Spirit. Now the word is teraphim, or teraphim. Teraphim is plural for comforter, teraphim in Greek. So the thing about it, brothers and sisters, this teraphim, the idols of Laban that Rachel stole, which ultimately led to her death, her husband Jacob spoke a curse. If anybody in my house took your idols, he told his father-in-law, Laban, you know, if anybody in my household took your idols, let them die, basically. And then Rachel died after that when she was giving birth to Benjamin. But her husband had really spoken that curse on her because she had taken the teraphim, the comforters, the idols of her father Laban. Now, the reason why she did that, okay, in ancient Canaanite tradition, I'm really getting in deep into this, and some of you guys really appreciate this. In ancient Canaan tradition, whoever had the idols had the power of the family. So that's why Laban really wanted to get those idols back. Laban. Why he wanted to get those idols back is because that's like his power. You know, his God power, he thought. His idol, his demonic power that he had. And his daughter took him by way of saying, hey, you know, you lost your children, you lost your grandchildren, you lost all your animals, and we even took your gods too. That's what Rachel was doing. You know, like slapping him in the face and letting him know that he lost everything because of the way he had been treating her husband, Jacob. And so the real thing that Loyola saw was these idols, these false gods, these... Now, I know I've never heard anybody teach this, and I know probably none of y'all have ever heard anything like this. That's what it was. Now that leads me to something called the, well, there's another name for it, but it's there's a guy named Nicholas Roerich. He's dead now. He was a guru. He's the one that is responsible for us having the Great Seal of the United States on the back of the dollar bill. It was added on by Franklin Roosevelt in the 1930s by the advice of his Secretary of Agriculture, Henry Wallace, whose guru, he called him his guru, his mystic teacher was a guy named Nicholas Roerich, who carried around a little coffin with him, a little tiny coffin, which contained these teraphim. That's what was in there, what they believe is teraphim. Now, these people think that it's the pillow that Jacob rested his head on when he saw his vision of Jacob's ladder, but it's not. If you research it and study it, you'll find it is the idols. Excuse me, it is the idols that Rachel had. I just probably need to write another book, a sequel to my book about this, because I'm really getting complicated here. And this is good stuff that the Lord is just kind of lining up for me right now as we're talking, as a matter of fact. So, these teraphim, these idols is what was in that thing, and that's what brings the New Atlantis. They want to make America the New Atlantis. Ultimately, that's one plan. That's the plan of the Rosicrucians, Sir Francis Bacon. Probably heard of him before. He was the one, the Rosicrucian, who was an advisor to Queen Elizabeth, and his whole thing was the New World will be the New Atlantis. The return of the gods. Return of the literal, not the representation teraphim, but the real teraphim, who are the Nephilim, who are the fallen, but their fathers, the fallen angels, Apollo, Apollyon. In ancient text, Apollo and Apollyon are interchangeable. That's why I'm telling you that the name of the Antichrist is in the book of Revelation. He's the beast that's the captain over the bottomless pit. The beast who makes war and kills the two witnesses is the beast that's the captain of the bottomless pit. His name is Apollyon or Abaddon, the destroyer in Hebrew. In ancient Greek writings of all these ancient Greek plays and all that, Apollo and Apollyon are used interchangeably. When Paul, the Apostle Paul, in the book of Acts, cast a demon out of a woman, in the NIV it uses really the right term, she had a python spirit in her, and she was following them around saying, these men have the, you know, the message of the Most High God. We need to follow them. We need to obey them. He cast out that demon. That woman was from the Oracle of Delphi. She was possessed by a python spirit, a snake spirit of Apollo, who is the beast out of the bottomless pit. That's the Antichrist. The spirit of the Antichrist is Apollo. That's what the Bible tells right in Revelation. Read it. It's right in there. That's who he is. And brothers and sisters, and what the God, the deities that you know in modern times from the Greek and the Roman, Mercury is the modern day name that you may see. Mercury, like the guy with the little hat with the wings on it and all that. Mercury is the fallen angel. He goes by other names. It's the problem with all these gods, these fallen angels, is in every different culture they have a different name. So you get confused. Osiris, Apollo, Horus, Apollo, they're all the same. Helios, same thing. Helios is also another name that the fallen angel, who is the Antichrist, who will become the Antichrist, used in a different place. Helios, Horus, Apollo, same fallen angel. Mercury is the name that the Antichrist fallen angel will go by. If you research it, you'll discover that. And I guess, you know, I could do a video on all these things. These are the powers and principalities and the fallen angels who are the spirits that will possess a person who will be the Antichrist and false prophet, or they themselves will appear on earth in the form of a man. I made videos way back when I first started about this. Angels appeared as men several times in the Bible. When they ate with Abraham, before they went in to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, there were two angels who went in to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. People thought they were men. The angel of the captain of the Lord's host appeared to Joseph at the Battle of Jericho. And Joseph thought, Joshua appeared to Joshua. And Joshua thought it was a man. And then the angel said, you know, take off your shoes, you're standing on holy ground. That's actually, as I mentioned before, a Christophany, an appearance of theophany or a Christophany, an appearance of Jesus before he came to earth in the New Testament. He appeared times in the Old Testament, the angel of the Lord. He appeared to Abraham with the two angels who went into Sodom and Gomorrah. Three people appeared to Abraham. He ate with them, and one of them he kept calling Lord. And he said, oh, you're going to have a child in about a year from now. And why is Sarah laughing at me? That's why they called him Isaac. Isaac means laughter. And then the Lord kept talking to him, and then those two angels went into Sodom and Gomorrah. The third one was no more, because it says the Lord stayed and talked to Abraham. Abraham interceded for Sodom and Gomorrah, and then the Lord went up, and those two angels went on. So, but the Lord, that's a Christophany, they call it. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I think I've been going on for 35 minutes. I'm just touching on all this stuff. If you want to look up something good, just to scratch the surface at one area of this, look up the Shepherd's Stone or the Lapis Exilis, L-A-P-I-S. It's the second word, E-X-I-L-I-S, Lapis Exilis. Now that is the Shepherd's Stone that is the Rosicrucian or the Knights Templar or the Rosicrucian painting that points to this Messiah that the Kabbalists are looking for from the bloodline of Joseph, from Rachel. There's a video about that. That's an excellent video of a code breaker, a professional code breaker who's looking at that painting to break it. It touches on these things. It's just one avenue that the devil's people are following to try to bring about the kingdom of Antichrist. Brothers and sisters, I've got notes and notes and notes and notes. I guess I'll call this part one. Anyway, France is a huge part of this. France, brothers and sisters. And in that, I just want to say this too. In that painting of Arcadia, Greece. Arcadia is Greece. I just want to say that too. So there we... I've been following it since I've been to the Philippines, about time the new Greek president, and there's lots of speculation about him. I have no idea if he is the Antichrist or not. He is a good candidate, I'll say that. He's an excellent candidate, so we'll see. He's talking the right talk, and he is an atheist. He's been talking with the Pope about bringing peace in Jerusalem too, so but that doesn't mean he's the Antichrist, but he's of the spirit of Antichrist, put it that way. He's got the right mindset. He's going in that direction. God bless you guys. I better cut it off. I'll just call this part one. On the trail of the Antichrist, the identity of the Antichrist, part one. God bless you guys.